Welcome. It's good to see you all here. Thank you for coming. First, we want to thank Denver Seminary for this wonderful venue. Tonight is actually the second of four presentations that Christians for Biblical Equality Denver chapter is hosting here in the chapel this spring. A few weeks ago, we held a landmark panel discussion titled, Is Male and Female Mutuality Biblical? If you missed that conversation, I encourage you to view it online at the CBE Denver chapter website. You just go to cbedenver.com. Then please liberally share it with your friends, your family, your coworkers, and your church community. Our speaker this evening is Dr. Douglas Groteis. Dr. Groteis contributed to the aforementioned panel discussion and is here again to bless us with his personal insights and scripturally informed wisdom regarding biblical equality. Dr. Groteis is professor of philosophy at Denver Seminary, where he chairs the Christian Apologetics and Ethics Program and directs the Gordon Lewis Center for Christian Thought and Culture. He received his PhD in philosophy from the University of Oregon in 1993. He is a prolific writer and a persuasive advocate for biblical equality. He's authored numerous books, including his magnum opus, Christian Apologetics, a comprehensive case for Christian faith. And if you've read it, it is comprehensive. He and his wife, Rebecca, have been leaders in the mutuality movement for over two decades. We now have the privilege of hearing Dr. Groteis share about his and his partner and wife, Rebecca's journey toward discovering and then courageously embracing a position of biblical equality amidst personal, social, and ecclesiastical challenges. His presentation is titled, The Lament of a Biblical Egalitarian. Please join me in giving Dr. Groteis a very warm welcome.
Well, let's begin with prayer. Lord, we are dependent upon you for all things, for creation, for redemption, for a glorious future in the new heavens and the new earth, in which there are no tears and no curse. Lord, may we learn together tonight through what I offer and through our conversation. May we learn of you, may we learn of what it means to walk as a Christian in this world. In Christ's name, amen. Well, I titled my talk, The Lament of a Biblical Egalitarian, to see if anyone would come. And at least some did. Why would anyone want to hear a lament? We sometimes use that word to simply mean complain, or gripe, or have a pity party. But a good reason to pay close attention to lament is that it's a biblical theme. There are many laments in the book of books, the scripture. Let's look at one in Psalm 13. I have this on the outline. How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? There are perhaps 60 Psalms of lament in the Psalter, and the lament is not limited to that book. We have the Book of Lamentations. We have Jesus lamenting over the unbelief of Israel. And I understand lament as a constitutive part of human experience under the sun and after the fall. We see lament in so many places. We see it in the Negro spirituals, the blues. We read of it in the genre of tragedy in literature. We hear it in dirges and requiems and so on. I want to give you a recitation of a classic Negro spiritual. There are many versions of this, and because this comes really out of an oral culture more than a written culture at that time, You'll find different versions of it. If you can listen to Jesse Norman sing it, listen, find that. I was thinking about trying to do that tonight, but that didn't work out. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. 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 A long ways from home. A long ways from home. True believer. A long ways from home. A long ways from home. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Sometimes I feel like I'm almost gone. Way up in the heavenly land. Way up in the heavenly land. True believer. Way up in the heavenly land. Way up in the heavenly land. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. A long ways from home. There's praying everywhere. I was tempted to break into song, but that would have been a big mistake. But you should hear it sung. You should hear it sung. Jesse Norman, Mahalia Jackson, if you can find that on YouTube. It's really tremendous. And these songs of sorrow and hope came out of the American black slave experience. And it's remarkable that so many of the slaves taken against their will from Africa ended up embracing the religion of their masters. But they did not embrace it with the same understanding. They embraced it as their way of liberation, that God knew the sufferings and struggles they were going through, and that somehow God would make a way for them. And so many of these songs were sung out on the property of the masters while they were doing hard labor. They were slave songs. And they carry with them great feeling. There is sadness. It is a lament. But it's also laced with hope because it's really rooted in a biblical understanding. True believer wants to be in heaven but feels like a motherless child. But there's praying everywhere. In just those few words and the many repetitions, you hear the heart of this lament. Now, what is a lament biblically? I just gave you an example from Psalm 13. As I said, about 60 psalms in the Psalter are psalms of lament. Sometimes a lament will be paired with a lot of petition. Sometimes it will be paired with imprecation, but there's 60 of the Psalms that have a strong element of lament. Glenn Pemberton's book, Hurting with God, is excellent on that. Now, in my life under the sun, given what Rebecca and I have been through, one of the books that has ministered to me the most, and this goes right back about 30 years or more, really, is the book of Ecclesiastes. And chapter 9, verse 11 is one of the most poetically majestic and existentially profound statements you will ever read. So Koheleth, the preacher, says, I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill. But time and chance happeneth to them all. That's how we experience life much of the time in a fallen world. The book of Ecclesiastes is not nihilistic. In fact, the word meaningless should be translated vapor. It means evanescent, fleeting, often disappointing. But it's a realistic account of life in a broken, wounded world. And Christianity, of all philosophies and all worldviews, gives us the intellectual and emotional resources to embrace without being suffocated by sorrow. And that's one strong reason why I am a Christian. There are many others. I did write that gigantic book. But I lately have been exploring Lament as a way of life. Lament as a apologetic for the truth of Christianity. Because when we suffer well with hope, then we are evidence that Christianity is true and meaningful. Now let me give you my definition of lament. This is in process. I understand a lament biblically to be the anguished cry of sorrow, grief, and often anger made before God, and sometimes with hope of resolution. Lament is caused by the loss of a true good or by the fear of the loss of a true good. One may lament over oneself, others, or the creation itself. Now let me give you a little bit on justifying lament. Some Christians think that it's our duty to be happy all the time. Now there is the joy of the Lord, which is deep and is deeper than lament. However, we have all been bruised by life, and many of us have been bruised repeatedly, and some of us even wonder if it's worth going on. But Christianity gives us the resources to live life fully in a world of lament and suffering. Now, lament morally is justified because if something is objectively good, like someone's talents in dancing or singing, and those are taken away, it is appropriate to mourn the loss of a true good. It is not sensitive, it is not morally aware to say, no big deal, or God has a plan, don't worry about it, it'll work out in the end. It is, I think, morally imperative to recognize objectively good states of affairs and to enjoy them, to celebrate them, and then, if they leave, to mourn the loss. Now, I'd like to talk about my own lament and something about my wife Rebecca's lament. And Rebecca is here tonight. I'm really glad she can make it. I have some essays in the back. One essay was a tribute to her work on the subject of biblical equality. And then there's another essay called Learning to Lament that goes into the philosophy and theology of lament more than I have time to do now. Rebecca and I were married in 1984, and at the time, I was not too sympathetic to feminism, the F word. And Rebecca was starting to investigate it, think about it. And over time, through study, through a lot of serious questions, we came to the egalitarian position, which I've written out here, indented, as all good philosophers do. Egalitarian, this position is that women, simply because they are women, are not barred from any position of authority in the church or the home. Therefore, women can be pastors and have equal say in marriage. It's very simple. That your gender does not restrict the possibilities of ministry at any level, in any place, at any time. Now, there may be other deterrents. It could be that in a particular culture, you don't want to present the church with a female pastor because that would be an unnecessary obstacle in that culture. But you would not be saying women should not be pastors because they're women. You would be looking at a contingent situation and having a missiological focus. You would say, well, just put that aside. Perhaps at another time it would be appropriate to have several pastors or several elders, one of whom is a woman. Now, Rebecca and I came to this view largely through observations. We noticed that men often, and even pastors, would make digs at their wives. Now, this is not unique to men. It goes the other way, too. But these negative comments were based on stereotypes. Like, women are too emotional and not rational enough. Women are more emotional than men. We can't trust women with a lot of authority. And Rebecca especially started puzzling over this and wondering, Why is this? Because people will sometimes justify this approach from the Bible about man being the head and so on. So she began a very thorough and long search of the scriptures and considering all the arguments for the other side, which could be called really patriarchalism. That's Rebecca's favorite term because it does, or hierarchalism actually, because it says that men are higher on the authority level than women simply by being men because of their ontology, their essence. And we began to consider all the arguments, and Rebecca took the lead, certainly, of the hierarchalists. And Becky, through the writing of her two books and editing Discovering Biblical Equality and her other writings, was as thorough as a well-trained bloodhound at looking at every possible argument for hierarchalism and against egalitarianism. All the biblical texts, all the theological arguments, the cultural considerations, the logic, she tried to approach it with, and she did, as a believer in biblical inerrancy. It was not an option to say that any biblical writer wrote something false. With a concern for systematic theology, we have to see what the witness of the entire Bible is, because if a view is true, it must be consistent with all of Scripture, and it must be consistent with all of reality. So those were the kind of strictures and incentives that she put on herself. Now, when Rebecca's books came out, Good News for Women came out in 1994, which was really a prolegomena, in a sense, because it had to do with the cultural, logical, and some of the hermeneutical issues to present it fairly, to deal with the stereotypes, and so on. And then her second book, Good News for Women, was more theological and exegetical. When Rebecca was working on those books, and when she received some very high commendations from noteworthy people like Vernon Grounds and Kenneth Conser and so on, we were pretty optimistic because Rebecca had thought through this so carefully and so thoroughly, and we dialogued about it all the time, that we thought this position is true. It's biblical, it's logical, and it frees women to use their God-given abilities that otherwise might not be used. We were very hopeful and optimistic that once the word gets out, that people will see that the case for egalitarianism is better than hierarchalism. Well, many people lauded Rebecca's work. To this day, I find many people who have been influenced profoundly by it or become egalitarians through her work. But what we didn't expect was the backlash. We didn't expect people to be unfair with Rebecca's arguments. And we realized that there is more than just argumentation going on here. There's a lot of emotion, a lot of personal history, fear of feminism. Rebecca wrote a booklet, it's just a classic, called The Feminist Boogie Woman. And that answers the basic charge that, well, you Christian egalitarians are feminists and feminism is secular and you're undermining the gospel and you're just aping the culture and all the rest of it. But we found not merely the opposition of opinion, but attacks on our personal character. And I have the names here because they went public. People like Wayne Grudem and Thomas Schreiner would give straw man arguments against Rebecca's arguments. They were so carefully laid out with documentation and qualifications. They wouldn't even read it seriously, apparently, because they would say, Rebecca says this, and that's obviously false. She knew it was obviously false, so you should have read it and thought about it. Now, part of this, I think, is male bias. Well, who is this? It's just some woman who doesn't even have a theological degree. You know, what would they have said about John the Baptist? What we thought was that the best scholars would take the argument seriously and respond appropriately. Now, some did, but those that were associated with the Council for Biblical Manhood and Womanhood basically had a scorched earth, take no prisoners kind of approach. If you have denied this position that we hold, which we take to be biblical, then you're pretty much on the wrong side. And with Rebecca's work, often it was not carefully analyzed. And I was just working through Rebecca's essay in Discovering Biblical Equality about the idea that women are equal in being to men but unequal in function, because there'll be a third edition of Discovering Biblical Equality. And as I was reading through it, I marveled at how careful and precise and how syntactically mature and how well documented that work was. That was a disappointment. It was a deep disappointment. And then there were other things, not merely unfair criticisms of Rebecca's work. There was some personal backlash as well. I'll give you one example, I guess, from about 10 or 12 years ago. I had shown interest in an academic institution, possibly working there, not Denver Seminary, I was already here. And the person that was in charge of the search said, "We are flattered that someone of your caliber would apply to our institution for this position. However, since you are an egalitarian, we would never consider you for this position because you're on the wrong side of the culture war." I won't tell you what happened next, but I rehearsed my credentials and I hung up. I essentially said, "I've been on the front lines of the culture war a lot longer than you have, and don't you dare say that." 10 years later, the man apologized. Apparently, it's stuck in his craw, and good. And now it's out of his craw, and almost out of mine. But those kind of things hurt. They make you angry. And you want to say, just hold on, let me talk about it. Let's think about this more thoroughly, more carefully. But that was what came with the territory. We had to deal with that. And there are a lot of other stories pertaining to that. But maybe a deeper sorrow is the fact that Rebecca wrote her books and I championed the cause as best I could because we wanted women to be free. We wanted women to use the gifts the Holy Spirit gave them to build up the church and to reach the world for Christ. That was the only purpose. Let's see if this is a biblical idea. Maybe it's just a secular idea pretending to be Christian. Let's look at all these details, as Rebecca did. And we both became convinced that it was true, it was rational, and it had deep meaning for Christian existence, for men and for women. I am now in my 24th year here at Denver Seminary, and I have taught so many bright, gifted, capable women. And in a 3-year period, about 10 or 15 years ago, women won the preaching award 3 out of about 4 or 5 times. Two in a row, and there was another one very close to that. Now, if you would have seen any of those sermons and you would have said, well, women really can't preach or lead, you would have blinders on. So people make justifications such as, well, women have these gifts, but they really shouldn't use them. And then you say, could you say that again? They have a God-given gift to build up the church, but for some reason, they shouldn't use them. And then, of course, we go back to exegesis and theology. But I had a student that took the doctrinal orals about 15 years ago. And he was a patriarchalist, a hierarchalist, or traditionalist, or as these folks like to say, a complementarian, but Rebecca never liked to use that word, and I don't either. But I said, do you think there are women here at the seminary that are gifted to teach and preach and lead, as gifted as any man? Yes. You think, though, that they're limited in the exercising of authority because they're women? Yes. And then I said, let that haunt you. Now, more recently, I have had to, and Rebecca's had to go through lament over Becky's inability to continue to engage this issue in the way that she used to do because of her illness. And it's tempting sometimes to think that given our present situation and given all the stress we went through on this issue, that it really wasn't worth it. Life would have been simpler if she had not pursued this cause and I had not joined her in pursuing it. But we both believe that it's the truth that sets us free, and we are bound to the authority of the Bible. We're here to glorify our God, to extend His kingdom by His power. And we want all people, men and women, on deck. We did have to deal with challenges and difficulties, and some, frankly, were quite vicious. I had an article published in 2015 in Christianity Today about my lament over Becky's illness. And I never received such an outpouring of concern and love from any article I've written in 35 years. It was remarkable and quite heartening. But there were some pretty nasty comments too, maybe just one. There was one comment on a blog saying that, well, Rebecca has this terrible illness because she's a Jezebel and because she has denied God and God is punishing her. I didn't have to respond to that because about a lot of my friends did. So I didn't have to do anything. Now that's just one cruel and irrational person, but that hurts, the fact that anybody would say something like that about such a vexing and agonizing situation that we find ourselves in. But we are convinced that this is true, that it's meaningful. And Rebecca and I have tried to think it through, apply it, talk about it, discuss it. And I've seen women flourish in leadership. Our own seminary students and graduates certainly are serving the Lord, women in various places, various parts of the world. And you really can't deny that God's working in them and through them, like Reverend Susan Bailey. But this is true, this does matter, and so it is worth the difficulty and the struggle. I want to talk a little bit about dealing with laments that don't completely resolve. And looking at Psalm 88, actually the whole psalm, I have it written out here. Because whether it's the biblical equality issue, illness, broken relationships, whatever it is, we don't find complete healing in this world before the eschaton. There are only two psalms that do not resolve into faith or praise or thanksgiving. One of them is Psalm 39, Psalm of David. And then there's Psalm 88, which I think is even more desolate. I'd like to read this and make a few comments about it. A song, a psalm of the sons of Korah, for the director of music, according to Mahalath something. Sorry, Aylin. I don't know how to say it. A maskil of Heman the Ezrahite. Lord, you are the God who saves me. It's a prayer. Day and night I cry out to you. May my prayer come before you. Turn your ear to my cry. I am overwhelmed with troubles, and my life draws near to death. I am counted among those who go down to the pit. I am like one without strength. I am set apart with the dead, like the slain who lie in the grave, whom you remember no more, who are cut off from your care. You have put me in the lowest pit, in the darkest depths. Your wrath lies heavily on me. You have overwhelmed me with all your waves. You have taken from me my closest friends and have made me repulsive to them. I am confined and cannot escape. My eyes are dim with grief. I call to you, Lord, every day. I spread out my hands to you. Do you show your wonders to the dead? Do their spirits rise up and praise you? Is your love declared in the grave, your faithfulness in destruction? Are your wonders known in the place of darkness? or your righteous deeds in the land of oblivion? But I cry to you for help, Lord. In the morning, my prayer comes before you. Why, Lord, do you reject me and hide your face from me? From my youth, I have suffered and been close to death. I have borne your terrors, and I am in despair. Your wrath has swept over me. Your terrors have destroyed me. All day long, they surround me like a flood. They have completely engulfed me. You've taken from me friend and neighbor. Darkness is my closest friend. Some translations say, all my friends are in darkness. Now that is a lament. But something I want to bring to your attention is that it is a prayer. It is an outcry of the wounded heart to a God who hears prayer, and a God who will hear without censure the deepest, rawest, painful expressions that we can give. This is, after all, in the Bible. It is Holy Scripture. It is divinely inspired, and it is profitable for our use and all the generations' use. And the last verse of that psalm is, darkness is my closest friend. We can cry, wail, we can be dejected, depressed, even despairing before the face of God without being embarrassed. Now, there's more to life than lament. But lament is, as I said, a constitutive part of human existence since the fall and before the eschaton, before the second coming and the events of the end. The question is really, will we suffer well, or will we suffer poorly and bring about even more suffering in ourselves and others? How do we live with irresolution? That's my point on page 5. The irresolution of an illness that won't heal. The irresolution of being a woman and having gifts that are not recognized by some denominations or some Christian organizations. Irresolution. With the Lord's help, we can, as I often put it, smelt meaning out of suffering. I'm quite inspired here by Viktor Frankl's classic book, Man's Search for Meaning. In any situation, no matter how dire and how painful, there is some meaning. And I think it comes down to love. No matter how difficult the situation, no matter how oppressed you may seem, we still, in God's strength, have the ability to show love in that situation. Love is patient and kind. I remember when I was visiting Becky in the hospital. It was a very tough situation, but I would go in and say, Lord, how can I show love? Of course, to Rebecca, she's my first concern, but how can I show love to people who are in such an unhappy, difficult, and sometimes frightening place? And I did find meaning. It was difficult. I often wept after I left. I sometimes, driving home, as a 30-mile drive, I just raged at God. But there was meaning, and God is a God who forgives and understands that we are weak, frail creatures. Find the meaning in any situation that is lamentable. What was the meaning for Heman the Ezrahite? He was still praying. He was addressing God. He was not in total despair. If he were in total despair, he wouldn't have prayed at all. Now, of course, the ultimate lamentation is that of Jesus on the cross. He quotes Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? I once talked to a woman at a church. I had preached the first sermon, and it was in between services, and she came to me. She said, I don't understand how Jesus can be our Savior when he lost his faith in God. And I said, he didn't. But he prayed, my God, why have you forsaken me? And I said, he was praying a psalm, and it was a prayer. And he was suffering for us, and it was agonizing. So he did not lose his faith or trust in God, but he lamented to the very depths of what is possible for a human being to feel. And of course, that was our redemption. He was dying to atone for the sins of the world. He was taking our place. He was defeating the devil. He was buried, and 3 days later, he rose again from the dead in space-time actuality. So of all the religions, all the philosophies of the world, the gospel gives us an open and accurate account of suffering, God incarnate suffering, a criminal's death, the most shameful death possible, and crying out to God in desolation. But in that was redemption, forgiveness, justification. Because of that and the resurrection, we look forward to a new heavens and a new earth in which nothing but righteousness dwells. There's no tears and no pain. We can find meaning in the midst of suffering. We can also remember what was good, what is good, and what will be good. So as Becky and I lament the losses we've experienced, I still remember, and I often call to Becky's attention, her books, her articles, and how profound they are, and they still have an ongoing ministry to so many people. And that is a gift of God. That's meaningful. Whether or not the books are in print or how many that sell, that work is part of intellectual history, and it has ramified in wonderful ways. And let's say you're in a situation where you're not using your gifts to the full because you're a woman and people are not letting you do so. You should seek release and seek the best place to serve, certainly in a humble, gentle, loving way. You can still be thankful for the opportunities that you do have, and that God gave you these gifts, even if they're not being fully used. So we have to try to be thankful even in the midst of misery. That's an art I haven't quite perfected, but it is possible. And then we think of the future. We think about restoration. I think it was just last night, Becky and I were eating, and I said, Becky, one day we'll join the heavenly choir. And she said, but you'll have to learn how to sing first. And I said, that's okay, because I'll have a lot of time. So that levity in relation to restoration and full redemption helps keep us afloat. But it is appropriate to honestly lament in season, alone, and with others. Scripture tells us that hope deferred makes the heart sick, comma. Just stay there for a minute. Your hope to pursue a certain kind of career may be dashed. Your hope to lead in the church or a Christian organization seems to be dashed because you're a woman. Hope deferred makes the heart sick, after the comma, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. Proverbs 13:12. We won't be completely fulfilled in life under the sun east of Eden. We won't be completely fulfilled in a world of tears and brokenness and disappointments and illness and being stereotyped because of our gender or being stereotyped because of our position. One of the things I guess I find humorous, but it's really pretty sad, is that some who criticize egalitarianism will say of Rebecca and me that we're liberal. If anybody's not liberal, it's Rebecca and me. We're very conservative. We're very biblically oriented. We don't want to make peace with culture if it's going to be sinful. But we continue to press on the best we can. We know that our heart will be somewhat sick, but there will be the fulfillment of everything that's good in the world to come, in the new heavens and the new earth. So through our laments about egalitarianism, about illness, about disappointment, whatever it is, we have a realistic hope that is kept alive through the biblical teaching, and we should lay hold of it. We can be encouraged by our brothers and sisters. We can be lifted out of some of our suffering through involvement with the church in worship and sacraments and so on. But I'll just sum up by saying that lament is a reasonable way to be in a fallen world. We don't have to suppress it. We don't want to lapse into self-pity and endless complaints and so on. But Scripture gives us, God gives us this way to live with evil and disappointment, and it's lament, lifting our concerns and desires to God, holding on to his promises, and hoping that our longing will be fulfilled, at least partially in this life, and completely when we're with the Lord forever. I'd like to, at this time, to take questions or comments if you'd like, and I need to say that if you do step up to the microphone, you are being filmed. And I had to say that for some reason. But this will go up on the webpage, and I guess we have the video of it. So if you do want to talk, you will be famous.
Hi. So I would wonder if you could speak to the balance or the pairing of lament and pursuit of social justice. Would you say that it's necessary if you're doing activism of some sort? Do you have any stories or anecdotes?
Oh, certainly. I would point to the civil rights movement in the United States and the leadership of Martin Luther King. He knew the language of lament from the Negro spirituals and from his biblical faith and from the church. But he also had tremendous hope at the same time. So you don't deny the oppression and the evils, but you're not completely swamped by them because you have hope, because with God all things are possible. I think that in that he is a tremendous example, of course a flawed man, but a tremendous orator and leader, and responsible for a lot of perhaps the things we take granted for granted now. But you need that deep feeling to care. You need to care about what's right, and you need to have moral discernment to figure that out. But read through the Gospels and see how many times it says that Jesus was moved with compassion and then healed someone. Moved with compassion and then acted on their behalf. I hope that helps, maybe a little bit. Yes.
I just wanted to comment. I lost my husband about 4 months ago, and I really appreciate that you are encouraging the lament, because the community of widows and widowers comes together because so many people there feel like outside of that, they are not encouraged to grieve beyond a certain period.
Right.
That their loss is not recognized, that they're told to get over it, to move on. When once you experience that loss, you feel like it's something that affects you for the rest of your life. So I really appreciate that you're encouraging the lament tonight.
Oh, thank you. I'm so sorry about your loss.
Thank you.
It takes courage to come up and say that. I appreciate that. Well, one way that I've tried to deal with my own lament is to write about it. I'm a writer. I write about just about every idea I've ever had. My motto now is never an unpublished thought. But this summer I wrote a book called Walking Through Twilight, which is something of Becky and my story. And it brought me to the place of thinking a lot about grieving, not just grieving over a spouse's illness, but death, disappointment, and I realized, and I've been thinking about this for years, that Americans are too impatient to grieve or let other people grieve. Our approach is, time's up, get on with your life. You can't put a timetable on grief. And in fact, you never get over it. You go on with life, but you don't get over these sorts of losses. They're incorporated into your being. And with the strength of Christ and encouragement, you continue to live and get up in the morning and do things that you are called to do. But I remember reading some years ago a short article by Danielle Steele, the novelist, and it was in one of the papers here after the Columbine apocalypse in 99. And she lost her young son to a suicide. Horrible. She wrote a book about it also. And she said, someone said to her, well, Danielle, you shouldn't really be grieving so much. It's been 6 weeks. Or maybe it was 6 months. It doesn't matter. You continue to grieve your entire life, but you don't have to be capsized by it or totally defeated by it. But show your scars. We have these scars. So part of Christian love is giving up the cliches and listening and letting people grieve at their own pace. 10 years ago, right here in this chapel, I had a teaching called Learning Through Lament, or Learning to Lament. And I said, for the last part of the service, let's simply voice our laments to God. And I said, no requests, just lament. And it was amazing what happened. People voiced all manner of concerns and pain. And one woman that I knew went home, went to her dorm room or the apartments, and said she cried for several hours. And when she told me that, I thought, oh no, what have I done? And she said it was good. She was crying over the loss of a marriage. Yes?
I have two questions. So my first question is, what is the balance of losing opportunity in churches because you are an egalitarian? So what is the balance of like being outspoken about that, but then, you know, you also might lose opportunity because of that?
Well, that's difficult because you can be convinced that biblical equality is true and rational and needful, and be in a situation where people are not very approving of that, and there may be a backlash against you. I guess I would invoke Jesus and say, be wise as a serpent and innocent as a dove, be prayerful, receive the counsel of good friends, and be realistic. There are some settings where God is doing good work, but people are not going to change in the near future. And there are some denominations that have institutional demands that women will not have certain positions of authority. And thinking that you can get that to change in the near future is probably naive. In fact, one of the things I do when I counsel female students here is say, make sure you can work with your denomination and use all of your gifts. And if you're in a denomination that is very stuck on their viewpoint, then perhaps you would use your gifts better and better serve another denomination. But we're all working for the cause of Christ. We all have blind spots. We're all sinful. But there is a place to say, I need to go somewhere else because I'm not being respected. But as I said, Becky and I were really surprised when we had all the backlash after Rebecca wrote the book. So don't be surprised. This can really touch nerves with people. And you can be caricatured, misunderstood. And of course it happens on both sides, but just be wise as a serpent, innocent as a dove, and try to be loving.
Great. Good answer.
Thank you.
And then my next question is, so I recently had a conversation with a friend who told me that I struggled with being an egalitarian because of my sexual assault in college. And so what would be your response to that? And like, what is a good way to respond? And what would be like the balance of like experience versus theology with
right.
that?
Experiences can spark a desire to study something out. That's really what happened to Rebecca and me. We kept seeing men put down women in certain ways, and we thought, why is this? Is this right? What's going on? So we embarked on this long study. But this commits the fallacy of, it's not a technical fallacy, but C.S. Lewis in God in the Dock has a chapter called Bulverism. And he said, the bulverist says, well, you just believe that because your potty training was bad. Or you just believe that because you were assaulted. Or you believe that because of some non-rational factor. That is irrelevant to the argument. What are the arguments for egalitarianism? What are the arguments against it? And yes, you had a traumatic, terrible situation. You were violated. But the real issue is, which view is correct? And it's also the classic fallacy of arguing against the person, really. You're saying, well, you only believe that because you're deeply wounded and you can't see reality properly. That's what the person really meant, and it was a he. It has to be he, right?
No, it's a
No.
Actually, a woman.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's not limited to men that will say this. But, you know, I'm sorry that someone would say such a hurtful thing. Goodness. But logically, it's irrelevant. It hurts you profoundly. And God will bring some healing to that. But look, read the arguments, lady. You know, read the arguments. Don't tell me what my psychology is in relation to my beliefs. That's irrelevant.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Anything else? Questions? Objections?
I have a question.
Okay.
So this is relating to more just the concept of lament in general in the church. At least in my experience, we don't lament much in the church. And mm-hmm. I think that probably comes from us being ahistorical in large
yes.
part and not having a theology of suffering. So how would you suggest being able to have these conversations about lament or bringing lament more into our congregations?
Well, as you said, look at the theology of suffering and lament and realize that the Psalter is the prayer book and in many ways the worship book of the church and for the Jews, and you find lament all over the place, directed to God. So it's a deeply biblical category, and when you look into historic liturgy, you observe the church year and you go through the stages of Christ's life. And the Lenten season in which we're now participating, is a season of lamenting over your sin and repenting and then working your way to Good Friday and Easter and so on. So I think that the historical liturgy, when it's combined, as it should be, with biblical faith, with orthodoxy, is very profound in ordering our emotional life around the deepest truths of the Bible and giving us a sacred rhythm. One of our students from some years ago, Zach Hicks, was a worship pastor at a local church, and largely through things that I had taught and Dr. Danny Carroll had taught, developed a service of lament. And it was very powerful in the symbolism, the teaching, the music that was sung. In fact, at my church, Wellspring Anglican Church in Englewood, the music changes during Lent. The music is in a minor key. So it's not really exuberant. It's more reflective, and it doesn't seem to completely resolve into happiness. So our feelings and our bodily engagement of the world is every bit as significant as our intellect. So we have to learn to live in the seasons of God, so to speak, holistically. And when you deny this fact of human existence that you find everywhere in the Bible, become very lopsided. And then people feel guilty for having these deep pains. And the idea for a lot of Americans is, we'll just snap out of it. Well, I can't snap out of it. I can get a better perspective. I can learn from the suffering. And then, as Paul says, with the comfort that I received in my suffering, I can offer that comfort to others. But let's just go back to the cross. The cry of dereliction, my God, why have you forsaken me? And of course, remember the resurrection. But in the Christian life, it's always cross-resurrection. It's not resurrection, period. You don't have a resurrection without a crucifixion. And God takes us through some harrowing, agonizing times on this earth. And we should individually and collectively be able to take note of that and try to learn how to suffer well. Not to bring suffering on ourselves, that's masochism, but to develop the skill of suffering well. That'd be a bestseller. That'd be my next book. Developing the Skill of Suffering Well. We'll see how that one goes. Yes, ma'am, you had a comment or a question?
Sure. One of the things I'm really seeing is if they are not working, the man and the woman are not working well together, I'm seeing a lack of spiritual and emotional maturity because they're not they're missing out on all the one another's, and it's like they're not even honoring the spiritual women among them. And then it happens in the home as well.
Well, if you have a view of hierarchy that just eliminates women from experiencing some things or having some abilities, then it's not a healthy relationship. It's not a relationship of mutual submission. It's a relationship of stereotypes and enforcing the rules. And that quenches the spirit. We don't want to quench the spirit. We want to see what gifts God has given in various people and how they can be fanned further into flame to extend God's kingdom and mission in the world. All right. Well, thank you so much for having me. And it's been kind of a personal talk, but I wanted to present some of the things that Rebecca and I have gone through. And just as a closing thought, despite all that we've gone through and the difficulties and the anguish of not being well received and, of course, of Rebecca's illness and all the challenges that that brings us, we are convinced that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. We are convinced the Bible is the inspired and without error word. And we are convinced that the message of biblical equality is the biblical message and that it needs to be known. Christ has come to set us all free and to use our gifts for his service and the service of the world. So in my lament is not despair. There are despairing times, but despair doesn't characterize the totality of our lives simply because we follow a crucified and risen Savior. And I hope you do as well.